This is Peter Dewdney speaking, Jack.
Okay, Pete, tell us what your connection is with Edgar Dewdney and so forth.
Well, Jack, Edgar Dewdney is the Dewdney that built the Dewdney Trail. Was the engineer in charge of it, you might say. Was my granduncle. It sounds like quite a distant relationship. But my father was an orphan, and he grew up with his uncle, Governor Dewdney. At the time when Dewdney was in Sir John A. McDonald's cabinet, Minister of the Interior, and subsequently he was Lieutenant Governor of B.C. in Victoria. So he was really like a father to my dad until he was about 18 years of age. So we feel quite a close affinity to the old gentleman. Just at the time he built the Dewdney Trail, he was only 22 years of age. And the later part of his life was perhaps the most interesting. When he was in Sir John's cabinet, and when he was Minister of the Interior, and in charge of all Indian affairs, and governor of the Northwest Territories, which included at that time Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba. He founded Regina. He was governor at the time of the Riel Rebellion. He signed the death warrant, actually. Rightfully or wrongfully, he signed the death warrant of Louis Riel, which I had at one time, but been unable to locate it in recent years. It's unfortunate. But my dad lived in Rossland on three occasions. He was a bank manager when I lived in Rossland, Bank Montreal, 1921 to 28. Prior to that, he was in Rossland about 1898 to 1904, and again around 1912. And as the, I guess, the teller at that time, he used to go from Rossland to the Leroy Smelter in Northport on horseback and bring the payroll down twice a month. Probably was a fairly lengthy trip in those days. It would have been
down and back.
I don't know. I never asked him whether he went down back one day. Probably did, the way the bank operated in those days. But he would have been a good target for a holdup. The trail, of course, ended at Wild Horse Creek over near Fort Steele, outside of Cranbrook. We were over there a couple of years ago when the Historical Society of the East Kootenai had a function. And we rode over 2 miles of the trail, which they had opened up. The trail ended at Wild Horse Creek. The view itself is well worth taking a trip to look at. It is a wild creek. And there's $25 million worth of gold taken out of the creek in the early days. And I think that's the reason they built the trail, because all the flow of traffic was north-south, and the idea of the B.C. government at that time was to try and bring the business to Vancouver. We were in Rossland, I guess Dad was in Rossland during the two big fires up there. I remember him telling how he rushed down to get the furniture out of the bank. The bank was the only building that withstood the fire, actually, that big fire. And I don't think his back was ever the same after carrying all that heavy furniture out.
I recall he was quite an active tennis player.
Yes, he was. He was a good tennis player. Tennis in his heyday around here in the 20s. They had some quite outstanding tennis tournaments in the Kootenays. Balfour was a famous tennis spot. There were no roads into Balfour, but the boats used to converge there. The steamers come in, and the old Balfour Beach Hotel, where they had national tennis tournaments. They did have a national tennis tournament there, wouldn't you?
Was your father very high? Was he a champion of sorts? How did he make that?
No, he was never a national, although he did play against, he did compete with two or three of the, with the national players, but he didn't really rate as a national player.
He was back in Rossland the second time in the 20s.
Yes, the 21 to 28, we were in Rossland.
Were you born there?
The house where Billy Coombs, or Benny Coombs lives now. No, I'm not that young, Jack. I was born in New Denver about 4 years prior to that. We lived in most of the mining towns in B.C., Sandon. We didn't live in Sandon, but lived in New Denver, and they used to bring the payroll. We used to go up to Sandon all the time. It was very active in those days. We'd go up on the speeder from New Denver to Sandon. It was quite a trip. Prior to that, he lived in Vernon. My sister was born there. Yes. He was older than I was in Rossland in those days. You knew her well, I guess. She knew you.
When did you leave?
Rossland? We left Rossland in 28. Came to Trail for a couple of years, and then we moved to Nelson. Dad retired in Nelson. I went to school, high school in Nelson. And then came back to Trail to work after the war.
Do you remember
from your Rossland days?
Outstanding?
Was it
attacked
in
the
Coanda
Beach?
Or
were they the rule of the day?
No, I do remember one of the fires. I watched it from the top of the hill, Columbia Avenue. I remember the whistle was blowing to end the last work shift at the mine. It seemed very sad to me as a boy at that time, but it was that night that the town pretty well burnt down. It seemed to, yeah. Or it's coming back nicely now. In those days, they didn't have the skiing, very little skiing done when I was a boy, but we did some tremendous sleigh riding. And Rossland, the Columbia Avenue, of course, you remember, was crowded with sleighs. But we would go down the trail quite frequently on the bobsleds, put them on the train. We'd go down the trail to go to a movie, put the sled on the train and come up in the afternoon, the late afternoon train, and jump off as it went by the house in Rossland.
As I recall, that train was like pretty well past you. Front door there, didn't it?
Yes, it did. There was a train that came by there every night at midnight, I remember. Very loud to somebody who wasn't used to it. I think the passenger came by in the afternoon. Late afternoon. There was another one at midnight. There were two passengers, were there, in those days? All things have changed.
Do you remember anything else about your father? Was he a bank manager in Washington? Was he a member of the Rossland Club or anything like that?
Yes, he was a member of the Rossland Club. He was always an ardent curler, a great hockey fan, as I was, of course. Most of the people wrestled were.
Hockey. Really top notch.
Yes, tremendous competition. We used to hate the Trail people and Nelson also. I remember going to the movie, watching Rossland playing Victoria. They'd won the B.C. championship. At least they'd won everything except the final. They played against Victoria. But they showed it on the movie. Must have been a day or two late. But I do remember.
And somebody wrote it down in the full slide.
I think that must have been how it was.
Well, it would be 15 or 20 minutes late.
Yes. I don't know the mechanics, but I remember clearly being very excited watching that in the old Rossland movie house.
That would be Fred Hackman's father's star theater.
What? I remember the star. I didn't realize that Fred I came back in the plane with Fred the other day. He was coming back from Whitehorse. For a holiday in Rossland. Of course, Fred used to go out and cut bits of the Dewdney Trail in the summer. He's quite familiar, much more so than I am, with the trail.
It's a bit of a hobby.
Yes, it was a hobby with Fred.
Well, that's pretty good. Do you think you really want that? Fair choices. Sure, we got it,
right? I don't know that I think of anything else, right there. Jack, good question, too. There was one incident Dad told me about. I think it was set out in Dewdney's papers, the time when he was Commissioner for Indian Affairs and Governor of Northwest Territories. The Indians used to meet once a year. They gathered together from across the prairies under the terms of the treaties they had with Queen Victoria. There was a certain date each year when they would be paid treaty money, and they were not too familiar with actual calendar dates. They'd usually arrive 2 or 3 weeks ahead of time and pitch their tents, and be a huge number of them. But they expected to get their money. They seemed to have a pretty good idea of the date when they were going to get that money. But oftentimes it was late arriving from Ottawa. And this one particular occasion was just prior to the Rio Rebellion. The Indians were very restless. The money didn't arrive. So Dewdney became a bit frantic, I suppose. But he went to the printers. He arranged for them to print some bogus money. And he also made an arrangement with all the stores of the trading posts in the district to accept this bogus counterfeit money, and the understanding, of course, it would be replaced. And this was actually paid out to the Indians at that time. It would be rather valuable if one could get hold of the odd bit of it today. I suppose he could have gone to jail for doing something like that.
I doubt it was his technique in handling the Indians that minimized the real rebellion, too, wasn't it?
Well, I think he his record in the whole affair was very good. He, of course, had to carry out orders pretty well from Ottawa. During the rebellion, he was really just carrying out instructions as the governor. Of course, feelings ran very high. It was very serious, as everybody knows, at that time. It doesn't look so serious now, looking back at it. As the Indian commissioner, he received a tremendous number of gifts from the Indians and had a marvelous collection of Indian relics. Sitting Bull was a great personal friend of his. Unfortunately, the old boy remarried when he was about 80 or so. He married an English woman, considerably younger than he was, a very fine woman. But for some reason, when he died, he left this, or he donated the Indian collection to a museum in England, Essex, I think it is. So it sits over there now. Just wondering if there'd be any possibility of them giving it back to the museum over here. It's probably unlikely.
I would think that representations
are
made, it might be possible. Provided they can be assured that they'll be possible. Yes. Well,
it's here. It'd be nice to get it back.
Well, Edgar Dewdney then was born in England.
He was born in England. He was a Royal Engineer. came out here as an engineer. He was hired as an engineer by the BC government to do some work for them. And this trail was, I think, the first job he did. And later on, he went into politics. He was a member for Yale originally, federal member for constituency of Yale, took in most of the Okanagan area, I think, at that time.
And then he went into the federal politics after that, didn't
he? Well, that was a federal constituency, Yale, federal riding.
Well, was he not in the, he wasn't in the colony legislature?
No, I don't think he was. No, he's never in the colony legislature. He became lieutenant governor in his later years, you know, of B.C., but that wasn't the most interesting part of his life. The most interesting part was on the prairies. And even the city of Calgary was not formally established by him, but it was pretty well located by him. Oh, yes. In those days, everything was, all the correspondence was handwritten. I had a box of papers, included a lot of letters from Sir John A., incoming letters. There were no outgoing letters, but he didn't keep copies, apparently. But that is now resting with the Glenbow Foundation in Calgary.
I suppose the other
Oh yes, the other end of it would be there, or should be there. I don't suppose it's lost. These letters from Sir John, some of them were quite interesting. Of course, politics being what they are, he was accused of a lot of things. He had a great enemy. Forgotten the name of the chap now. But when he decided on the site of the city of Regina, they called it the Pile of Bones, you know. And the accusations were made that he had personal property in and around that particular spot. This is Dewdney. But what he wrote, his personal letters from Sir John indicated that this was really Tommy Rot. Politics. But they didn't mince any words in what they said in those days. I noticed the other day there's a program on TV, I think it was Diefenbaker who was talking about Sir John, stories about Sir John. He was quoting some of the phrases and expressions used in the House of Commons in those days. What some people said about Sir John and what Sir John replied was today it makes the Parliament seem rather tame.
Did Dewdney ever get involved with the CPR call while he was on the prairie?
I didn't, I've never seen anything connecting him particularly with the CPR, or building a CPR. See, that might have... Well, I suppose it was during the time he was in the cabinet, all right.
CPR, of course, did get troops out to the prairies when the Real went down, didn't it? Finished the certain part of the line
of the prairies. Yes, I think they did, Jackie. The only... let's see now. I can't remember what I was going to say in that connection, Jack. The now the only thing I can think of about the CPR that I recall are some of these letters that were addressed to Dewdney that I used to have, the envelopes. They were addressed to him, CPR West of Winnipeg. Seems like a pretty vague address. Yeah.